Thank you, Rama. I don't think Professor Jayati Ghosh really needs any introduction, either to us in JNU or to the larger intellectual community. But nevertheless, as you know, Professor Ghosh has been here teaching for more than two decades, nearly three decades. And so she has been part and parcel of JNU's journey and maturing. You would know her famous monographs, you know, The Market That Failed being the more recent one. She's also authored the West Bengal Human Development Report, the report on the Commission on Farmers' Welfare for Andhra Pradesh. And not too long ago, her book came out, which is Never Done and Poorly Paid, Throwing Light on Women's Work in Globalizing India. What many of us don't know that she's also an eminent music critic, regularly contributing critique of Western classical music performances, and occasionally director of the Delhi Music Society. So without further ado, may I request Professor Jyoti Ghosh. She'll speak on the anti-national policies of the NDA government.
Thank you very much, Rajashi, and thank you, all of you. You know, I have to say, Rajashi mentioned, I've been now, this month, it's three decades of teaching in this university. Before that, I was a student here. But you know, I have to tell you, I have never been prouder of this campus than I am today. And you know, we used to always say that this university is actually made by its students, and we also knew it. But to know it in this way, how much we are learning from all of you. We teachers are learning from all of you in terms of your political understanding, your discipline, your maturity, your creativity is just amazing, and your courage and resilience. Please keep that courage and resilience. We're going to need it. It's not over, okay? We're going to need it. But I really have huge, huge faith and optimism when I just see how smart you guys are. You continue to surprise me. Please continue to keep surprising all of us with this incredible smartness and political savviness. So thank you all, really, from the bottom of my heart. Okay, so this title is anti-national economic policies. Now, I know anti-national is not a word we agree with, right? Especially because anti-national has always been, well, in the last few years particularly, it has really been used to fix any opponents of the government, okay? Protesters against Kudankulam nuclear plant are anti-national. Those who are looking at the rights of displaced people are anti-national. Those who are talking about, you know, bauxite mines not being built in villages that invade tribal rights and so on are anti-national. This is typically how it's been used in the discourse. And of course, now we know that this whole campus is anti-national. Like, we're all, by definition, anti-national. Now, in fact, what is a nation? Okay, a nation, ultimately, as we all know, is its people. And the point about recognizing that the nation is its people is that then you also recognize that a person cannot be anti-national. That in fact, the only thing that can be anti-national are policies, often state policies, and in particular now, most recently, what we have found in terms of state policies. So, okay, we're a nation. Now, what does it mean that we are these people? And ultimately, the thing we have to keep going back to, the thing that defines us, thank heavens, still, is the Constitution. Okay, so we have to look at that Constitution. A lot of talk. You people are probably have got Constitution coming out of your ears by now, right? Because there's been a lot of discussion about the Constitution. But I still want to go back to that because I think it is the defining thing for us as a people. Because that Constitution was definitely the remarkable, remarkable legacy of Dr. Ambedkar, but it was also the result of a national movement that positioned the people of India against imperialism, against colonialism. And it positioned itself in a way that therefore created a positive concept of the nation, not a negative one defined in terms of another, some enemy out there whom you have to bash or defeat or something, but a nation in terms of what it is going to offer its people. And that's why the preamble to that constitution is so very important. I know you're bored of it. Let me just remind you again, once again, what's in that preamble. It is not just about the sovereign, secular, socialist, democratic republic of India. It says that this is going to actually ensure for its citizens certain things, okay? And I think the order of those things, again, is very important. What's the first thing is going to ensure? Justice. Justice, social, economic, and political. Now, bear in mind, even that justice, the first part of that justice is the social justice. Then the economic justice. Then the political justice. Okay? That's quite interesting. That's the very, very first thing, the most important thing that we have to ensure to citizens. Okay? Then what's the second thing? Liberty. Okay, liberty of expression, of thought, of religious views, and so on and so forth. We know about that one, right? We've had good cause to know about the significance of that second promise, that second need to ensure to citizens the liberty of freedom of thought, of expression, of belief, of worship, and so on and so forth. What's the third one? Equality. Again, remember, this is the third thing that is promised that the people of India should get, equality in terms of status and opportunity, okay? And what's the fourth one? Fraternity. Okay, wrong word, but you know what I mean. And remember, it's coming from the French Revolution and so on, but broadly, fraternity, and fraternity has two parts. Fraternity first in terms of the dignity of the individual, and then in terms of the unity and integrity of the nation. Now, note that these are, if you like, the essential building blocks of what we consider our nation. To the extent that we love our flag, to the extent that we actually are proud to be Indian, to the extent that we see ourselves as nationalists, it's because we believe in that vision. And so, I would argue that things that undermine those are, in fact, anti-national. Policies and processes that undermine those are anti-national, because they are against the idea of this nation, they are against the promise of this nation, they are against whatever defines us as India. Nothing else defines us, okay? There is nothing else, because of course we love talking about how diverse we are and how, you know, many different types of things we have, and it's true, we contain everything. There's this professor I used to have in England who used to say, whatever you can say of India, the opposite is also true. So if you can say that there is fascism in India, you can also say, thank heavens, that there is anti-fascism in India, you know? So now let me look at the economic aspects of each of these. Because these, of course, were promises. But of course, they're promises, goals, aims that we're still working towards. India is still a nation in progress. It's a nation in the making. And certainly that ideal of the nation in the making, we have a long way to go. We know it. I'm telling things to all of you that you know already. You're all highly, highly sophisticated in all this understanding. So I'm just repeating things you already know. But nonetheless, let's look a little bit at each of these elements. Justice, okay? Now, when you ask for economic justice, you're asking for justice for all citizens, all people in the country. In fact, the word citizen often is a bit also problematic, because it tends to, the definition of citizenship is often, you know, crazy. It's still significant because it is the terrain on which we can demand rights for our people. Okay? The social, economic, political rights that we demand, that must be realized by our state, are defined in terms of the notion of citizenship. So that's why they're significant. So when you say economic justice, what are the kinds of things in which, let us say, policies of the last few decades have really been not providing that kind of economic justice? And I don't necessarily want to get into legacy issues. I think we all know the legacy issues. We know the kinds of deep divisions that were created by colonialism, perpetuated thereafter. We know about, you know, the inequalities that existed, deep structural inequalities. I'm talking now about policies, because remember, this is about being anti-national. It's not about things that you were handed down and have to deal with. It's about actively denying justice. So where has justice been denied? Well, let's look at the condition of workers. India is the only country in the world, okay, where we have such a loose definition of what is a worker in the formal sector worker, okay? So we categorize our workers into formal and informal. And as you probably know, more than 96% of all workers in India are informal. Okay? And that doesn't even count the ones who are not recognized as workers, who do a lot of work. I'll come to those. 96% are informal workers. And what do you need to be called a formal worker? You need actually only one of three things. You need to have a paid, a signed contract, okay? Or, not and, or you need to have paid leave. Or, not even and, you need to have any kind of social security, a pension, a medical benefit, anything. Any one of these makes you a formal worker, and yet only 4% of our recognized workers are formal workers. Imagine that. What has happened over the last three decades? That proportion has come down, believe it or not. We moved from about 5% to slightly under 4%, actually 3.8% if you look at the latest NSS data. Okay, so here is a way in which we are happily recognizing that not only do most of our workers, the dominant, overwhelming proportion of our workers not have any of these things, but their share is actually increasing. Those who have even one of these things, that share is falling. Okay? Then you find that among those, the share of income, the national income going to wages, is continuously falling. This is coming out from our national income data. It's even coming out in the formal sector. When you look at that privileged 4%, that privileged 4% is either, well, some of us happen to be here in JNU, but we are not even, you know, 0.1% of those. But those in organized factories, those in organized establishments, and so on. So where we have data on the organized establishments, we find that the share of wages, even in those organized establishments, is falling. And the share of profits, interest, and so on, is rising. It's been really sharp in the last 10, 15 years. In fact, over the 20-year period, the share of workers in value-added in organized manufacturing has gone from about 14% to about 8%, which is, by the way, one of the lowest in the world. Okay, I haven't looked at Pakistan, but pretty much everywhere else, we are lower than. Okay, so clearly, in fact, in terms of justice to our workers, we're not providing it. But there are other ways in which we don't provide justice. We don't provide justice to the huge category of farmers who are not classified as working for anybody else. They're part of the self-employed group. Those who are cultivators, the share of national income going to cultivation has been falling continuously. The Prime Minister, you may have, some of you heard in the budget speech, the Finance Minister said they're going to double farmers' income in 5 years. Well, if it's the money income, that's no big deal because, you know, everybody's money income kind of doubles in 5 years, if it's the money income. If it is the real income, well, that too is interesting because, you know, currently, guess how much the average farmer in the country receives? It's close on to, it's less than 3,000 rupees per month, net income. Okay? We are talking about actually farmers unable to survive on farm income. And my colleague Vikas Rawal, who's done a lot of surveys across the country, will tell you that he has found farmers across India who have negative incomes from farming. And the only way they survive is by actually somehow doing other stuff that will enable them to get an income. So what has happened in the past 10, 15 years particularly, well, 20 years really, is that farming has become completely unviable and it's getting worse and worse. This government has had an all-out attack on agriculture, in fact. There was a phase when farming, there was a deep crisis, as you all know, from the mid-90s. A lot of farmers committed suicide. By the mid-2000s, when UPA-1 came to power, there was some kind of attempt to actually revive farming. There was a slight improvement in what farmers were getting, and you know, it was marginal. At the margin, there was some improvement in conditions, some more access to credit, some more access to imports, that kind of thing, okay? This government has actually systematically eroded all those protections. Under the guise of fiscal responsibility, it has massively cut the money going to farming. They realized that this wasn't so popular, so in the latest budget, they have pretended to reverse it. When I say pretended, because it's all lies. Okay, we're used to a lot of lies from the government. The way they fudge the money part in this one is to shift heads of budgets. So a subsidy that used to go to banks that provided credit to agriculture, which a lot of it, by the way, doesn't necessarily go to agriculture, but that subsidy was moved from the finance ministry to the agriculture ministry. So suddenly you get a 15,000 crore increase in agriculture budget, which is not true at all, okay? The total money increase going to agriculture is tiny. It is 0.01% of GDP. I mean, negligible, not enough to make any kind of difference to the crisis that we know farmers are facing. Because we know that farmers are facing rising input costs, they're facing terrible climatic conditions, 2 years drought in a row, they're having terrible difficulty in terms of the marketing. There is a huge crisis in agriculture at the moment. And yet, nothing is being done. In fact, if anything, there's been a systematic decimation of the viability of farming. Then there's the other huge bunch of self-employed who are not farmers, who are actually, well, the term that is popular now is MSMEs, micro, small, and medium enterprises. A micro enterprise is a person, okay? So, you know, that lovely old man who sells fruit on the road over there is a self-employed micro enterprise, okay? This is the kind of employment that now actually accounts for more than half of the non-agricultural workers. They are self-employed, which means they're running their own businesses, if you call that a business, surviving whichever way they can. Guess what? The share of that in the GDP has been falling systematically. That is to say that entire informal sector share has been falling continuously in GDP very sharply in the last 5 years. We don't have the data for the very last year, but the evidence is that it's going to be even worse because the policies for this huge bulk of 97% of the workers and this informal sector, the policies for these remain non-existent. In fact, if anything, they are really against them. So, for example, 96% of workers employed in informal sector, guess how much share of bank credit they get? 2%. Now, is a Jan Dhan scheme going to give them access to bank credit? No. Because you all know about the Jan Dhan, right? And JAM and so on and so forth. What it does is to create often fictitious bank accounts into which they promise to provide subsidies, which typically will replace public provision of essential goods and services, okay? And it doesn't actually allow you access to credit. All of these people are forced to survive on informal sources of credit. I'd like to see Mr. Ambani, for example, pay the 25 to 30% rates of interest that all informal enterprises have to pay as a norm, because that's what the informal credit market rates are, 25% plus. Then, in fact, we ignore these other workers, which is to say the entire group of people who are not recognized as workers at all. Dominantly women, but also a lot of men as well. We often think that, you know, unpaid work is only the stuff that happens in households. And it's true, a lot of it does happen in households, a lot of it also happens in communities. But this unpaid work is actually work that is critical for the survival of society, and it's also critical for production. It's not just what we call social reproduction, you know, the care economy, looking after the old, the young, the sick, and so on and so forth. It is also a whole range of production services inside households, which is to say those that actually, you know, enable households to process food themselves, to do other services, collection of water, collection of fuel wood, collection of a whole range of things. We find that there is this massive reliance of the formal economy on this unpaid, unrecognized informal economy. Now, what's wrong with that is that the conditions of those workers have actually got worse as well over time. There is really an attack on those because we are making it more and more difficult and more time consuming, for example, to collect water or to collect fuel wood. We are not thinking of policies that would actually provide piped water, piped fuel, ease all of the burden of unpaid work and so on and so forth. And then there is the whole category, I don't know what to call them, underpaid workers. You will have heard that Kanhaiya's mother was an Anganwari worker. Anganwari workers are among this huge increasing category of underpaid workers, underpaid by the state. They use the fact that so much of women's work is not recognized, not paid, to actually provide women with so-called paid work at well below the minimum wage. So Anganwari workers get 3,000 rupees a month, Anganwari helpers get 1,500 rupees a month, which really is something like 1/4 of the minimum wage in most of the states that they are operating in. And yet they're expected to do an entire range of activities. They're expected to do a huge amount of work in a day, 17 functions that Anganwari workers have to fulfill. ASHAs, accredited social health activists, actually don't even get that much. They get 500 rupees in some states, 1,000 rupees in some states. Which is, they don't therefore call it a wage. They call it an honorarium because ASHAs are activists, the volunteers. They're doing this because they love, you know, helping the people, not because they need or deserve a minimum wage. And yet our public health systems, our public nutrition systems run entirely on this. Okay, so many, many ways in which we are economically unjust. We're also economically unjust because our pattern of development has actually dramatically displaced workers, displaced people from their livelihoods, displaced people from their land. And those who are displaced do not have access to the minimum kinds of compensation, rehabilitation. The attempt by this government to bring in a new Land Acquisition Act that would actually not provide even the minimally adequate compensation is all part of this thing of not recognizing the need for justice to those who are affected by particular growth strategies and development. Okay, so that's in terms of economic justice. Let's think about equality. Now, we know that India is a very unequal society. We know that India is a very unequal economy. We often celebrate the fact that, you know, and economists do anyway, that in terms of Gini coefficient, we have a relatively low Gini. That doesn't mean anything because that measures only consumption, not income. And we leave out the very rich. You know, the people who do surveys don't go and measure Mr. Ambani's consumption, for example. But they also leave out the very poor. They don't actually go to people who don't have homes because it's all house-based. So you're leaving out the very poor, you're leaving out the very rich. Now, this in turn means that we actually have a much higher inequality than our official data suggest. Everyone who's actually gone out to local areas and done income surveys has found much, much higher inequality, maybe double that which the official surveys give us. Okay? But we don't need to, I mean, we don't really need to be told this. We know that it's there because we can see it. Just to give you an idea of how it has changed, you know, India has a lot of dollar billionaires. We're very proud of them, right? Because one third of the world's dollar billionaires now come from India, okay? Last year, we have 111 dollar billionaires. The latest report that measures this, the dollar billionaires' income went up by 25% in India. Wow. Now just imagine, our GDP was only 7%, but our dollar billionaires got 25% hike in their wealth, okay? Not bad, we're doing all right for the dollar billionaires. Somehow we're delivering for them, okay? One of the ways in which we do all right is in fact through things like fiscal policy. Because we actually don't tax, we have very low tax rates. We don't implement those tax rates. We don't actually go out there and make an effort to raise taxes. So, you know, we're proud of being the BRICS and the G20. In the BRICS and in the G20, we have the lowest rates of tax incomes to GDP in all of these countries. We, India, we have the lowest. So no wonder we don't have money for public services. No wonder we don't have money for schools and hospitals or your scholarships or proper public universities and so on, because we do not raise those tax revenues. And along the foregoing revenues, so they've changed it to some other fancy phrase. I've forgotten now exactly what. But, you know, statement of implications of tax incentives. So, okay. So what are these implications of tax incentives? Well, this year, according to the budget, 551,000 crore. Okay? 551,000 crore. That's more than the fiscal deficit. It is, let me put this in perspective. You know how Mr. Jayati made a big song and dance about how he was giving so much money to the rural employment guarantee. In fact, he's not. Huh? It's a big cheat because you have to reduced from that 6,500 crore that he's already owes to the state governments for last year. But let's assume that there's 38,000 going to the MNREGA. That compares with 551,000 crore. Okay? Think of it. We are talking more than 10 times. We're talking about 14 times. The amount is just a giveaway to corporates and to various kinds of tax concessions. Rebates on corporation tax alone come to 68,000 rupees. 68,000 crore, I'm so sorry, on corporate tax alone, okay? So huge giveaways every year, which are the recognized giveaways. We're not even talking about the unrecognized giveaways. We are not even going, entering into the, all the bad corporate debts. Mr. Malia, for example, you know, who continues to own his islands and his etc. And he's very angry because he's being made to give up one of his planes. So there is a huge way in which we actually massively subsidize the rich corporates, the rich elites, the rich in general. When it comes to subsidies, however, we never mention them as subsidies. Subsidies are only the things that affect the poor. So food is a subsidy. Whereas what we are actually doing is ensuring the production of food in India and ensuring or trying to ensure, this is what the idea of the food distribution program is, this is what the promise of the National Food Security Act is, would be to ensure that every household gets a minimum amount of grain that is required for human consumption. This is not a big deal globally. Huh? The United States has been doing this for a very long time. Europe has been doing this for a very long time. The Southeast Asian, all these Asian tigers that everybody raves about, they've all been doing this for a long time. Every country that has developed has had strategies to ensure local food production and the distribution of minimum required food to the people, except us. We have, of course, announced it. But this government has once again cut the subsidy that it wants to give for it. So in terms of inequality, we are actually massively living in a world where there are dramatic increases in inequality as a result of policy, not just because of some big world out there and the forces of globalization, but as a result of policy. So in that sense, if you're looking at equality as a third major peg of what we want to define as our nation, these are deeply anti-national. Then, of course, there is the very fact that you cut the public expenditure on all the things that provide the basic needs of people. We all know that one of the first things this government did was when it came in, by the middle of the first year of its existence, it started cutting hugely on health, education, sanitation, nutrition. It's a joke, huh? The year of Swachh Bharat, there was a big reduction in the sanitation budget. But, you know, etc., etc. So there has been massive, massive cuts in all of these essentials. Now, what happens when you actually reduce these, when you cut health spending? Are people going to say, oh, well, too bad, health spending has been cut, I just won't take my mother to the doctor? Doesn't work, right? You go private. We have the highest proportion of private out-of-pocket spending on health in the world. World, huh? We've beaten Sub-Saharan Africa, we've beaten Pakistan. We should be happy we finally beat Pakistan, etc. We have actually got the worst in terms of public health provision to our people. And guess what? It's got worse. We now have situations where many states in the country are not able to run the primary health clinics because the center has dried up the money to such an extent. We have a situation where education at all levels is being massively affected and being privatized because of the failure of the public sector to deliver. So when you actually do this, it's a huge way of creating inequality. Education goes to those who can afford it. Health goes to those who can afford it. Sanitation goes to those who can afford it. Now we know even clean air goes to those who can afford it. Right? Because otherwise you have to live in, you know, the out greater polluted, congested world, and you have to get the lung disease compared to the people who can travel in the cars with the filtered air. So in terms of equality also, we've had, I believe, a massive attack on the basic essence of what the nation is. Now let's finally look at fraternity, and most of all, at the dignity of the individual. And this is there in the preamble, the dignity of the individual. Now we're straying away from economics, in a way, because we are actually moving to a situation where we are talking about how we have very, very long millennia of indignity to contend with. No doubt about it, right? We have the most complex historical systems of discrimination, exclusion, hierarchy in the world. You name it, we've got it. We've got caste, we've got gender, we've got ethnicity, we've got religion, we've got language. We have so many different ways of creating not just differences, but of denying dignity to people. I still believe caste is probably caste and gender are the primary ones, because they have created not just an acceptance of inequality among many people in our society, but also a lack of sense of human dignity of everyone. And that reflects in so many different ways. But it also reflects crucially in terms of how we do our economics. So that anything that happens, that's why, you know, the rights-based movement was a critical movement, and I believe it also relates to the movement of the awakening of oppressed groups and communities, of Dalit awareness, of women's movement, and so on and so forth. Because, you know, the rights-based demand is not the my bap state. It is not saying, you know, please give us a little bit and, you know, help us and so on. It is a demand of a citizen for their basic rights. And I think this is something that is being sought to be eroded very, very systematically, particularly by this government. Because the idea, have you noticed, it's completely gone from the public discourse. I mean, there's nothing in the government statements that talks about rights anymore. And in fact, the bureaucrats who are very quick to sense these changes in the wind and so on, the minute you mention rights, they say, oh, no, don't talk about all that. That's all kind of very last year. Let's move on to, you know, the new things, the jam and, you know, the things like that. Now, what is all of this doing? It is providing benefits, direct benefit. Please note, it's not a right. It's a benefit. We're giving you a goodie. Okay? We're going to give it straight in your bank account. We are not going to check about whether it actually gives you food to eat or whether it actually substitutes for the price that you pay for a certain essential good or service, or whether it actually is something that will enable your child to go to school or you to enable a health service, because it will not be enough, okay? But we will give you a gift of some money in your bank account. It's a benefit. It's the Mai Baap Sarkar coming back, which fundamentally denies dignity to the recipients and does not make them recognize their rights and demand this as something which must be available to every citizen. Decent quality, good quality healthcare, good quality education as a right of every citizen. No. We'll give you a little bit of money, now you go out there and find it. And see how good we are. We're giving you some money. So you should be grateful to us. So the erosion of that dignity comes in addition to the millennia of indignity that we impose on so many of our people. It's a worsening, and in that sense, therefore, it's a strengthening of that peculiar form of inequality that we have in India, which denies dignity to the people. Okay, so these are all the various ways in which this government, I believe, has been deeply anti-national in its policies. Anti-national in this way.
Sure that some of you may be having some questions you would want Professor Ghosh to engage. So if you raise your hand, I can bring the microphone to you. You don't have to really ask a difficult economic question.
Ma'am, I missed to listen on the current taxation on PPF and EPF. So can you say something on that?
Any other question that you would want to club together with this one? Which you want Professor Ghosh to address?
Okay, let me first answer that he was asking about the tax on the EPF and PPF in the latest budget, which he expressed very sweetly. He said, I'm going to exempt from taxation 40%. He didn't mention that, therefore, I'm adding a tax of 60% of it. Now, this is, in fact, very nefarious. Because, as you know, the idea is really to shift people away from a stable source of retirement income into a very unstable and volatile source. Why is that? Because, you see, if you invest in mutual funds and various market-driven things and so on and so forth, or all these insurance policies, you really are prone to the volatility of the market. The EPF and the PPF, because of the resistance of the trade unions, have been protected from that volatility. They give you secure rates of return. And this, of course, is seen as a big incentive to keep your money in the PPF. And it's a fair incentive because it's ensuring that people who have actually worked continuously and who save to put their money in that will actually get a minimum insured, safe, regular source of income. what's really being done here is to shift people away from that, because now 60% of that is going to be taxed. Now, if that's a huge thing, why would you keep your money there if you know that when you retire and you need the money, more than half of it is going to be taxed at 30%? So the incentive then would be to keep it in something which you think was not, or not taxed as much, or which will be taxed, but offer you higher returns, so-called higher returns at the time being, but are market linked. Now, once you get into that, you are then exposed to the vagaries of the market, and you are subject to all kinds of possibilities in terms of the income. The purpose of the government here is to shift people away from the secure savings that EPF, PPF provide and force them into these market-related things. This happening anyway. You know that, you know, the national savings schemes, which used to provide a secure amount at the end, have been more or less phased out. The postal savings are being undermined. Various things which would provide a secure source of saving, risk-free source of saving, are basically sought to be undermined to push people into the market-driven. And this is part of a broader thing where you're also trying to push people into market-driven insurance. So instead of giving health services, you say, I'm going to give you health insurance. Okay, and you pay a premium and then you go out to a private provider. Instead of giving proper incentives for crop production by giving a minimum support price and some support on inputs and so on, you say, I'll give you crop insurance, which you pay the premium, I'll help you a little bit with the premium, and then we'll see if that private company will give you the return when you need it and so on. So there are various ways in which, in fact, it's really pushing people into these financial sector agencies which are not finding an adequate market at the moment.
Whenever we talk of taxpayers' money coming to the education or health funding, so there's been a lot of noise over a period of time of how we are wasting the taxpayers' money. So in the budget statement, I'm not pretty much sure how the revenue foregone is clearly mentioned. Whereas, because even with the, I remember with the, in a very recent another economics lecture, there was also the customs and central excise foregone, you know, which happens in the ports and the airports. So if we club up all these, I mean, it will constitute more than 20,000 crores. Well, I don't even know how many zeros exist.
Okay, let me get you, what I mentioned as this, you know, so-called tax incentives in the budget. It, the total, that is to say, the incentives on corporate tax, on customs, on excise, all of them say, all of them taking together is 551,000 crore. Okay. Yeah, zeros become a bit complicated, right? So what are we talking about? We are talking about approximately 5% of GDP, okay? To give you a sense of it, how much are they spending on the employment guarantee, which they're going on and on? 0.21%. 0.21, they're here, we're talking more than 5%, okay? How much in terms of the total education spending? That's about total, everything. That's about 3%. Higher education gets how much? Less than 1%, 0.8%. Okay? These are so just the corporate spending, 68, the tax incentives to corporate, 68,770 something, okay? That's just last year, okay? If you take for the last 5-10 years, you are going to get in the trillions and trillions and trillions of rupees. Okay? But the corporate tax is 68,000 rupees, well above the total higher education budget. So you are getting the picture. Yeah? Maybe double the high, I have to go and check. More than double, maybe 5 times the higher education budget. So you are not beneficiaries of taxpayers' money. You are people learning to be contributors to society. Society needs you.